just does some ugly passing rendering.
It's kind of like Helmet.
Exactly, yeah.
Right.
I think it's based on Helmet, yeah. So.
It's just passing with children would be where it needs, right?
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Just passing.
That's
what I need to put in there in the headups.
Can a Spark client call a server-side rendering function and then you'll get a response from the server-side renderer back to the Spark client and then renders that component?
Well, if you're calling a server-side rendering function, it'll return HTML.
Okay.
So yeah, you can't, I don't, well, you probably could create an API with this, but I think normally you're going to be rendering HTML. You could throw whatever head tags on it you want, probably.
Plus, you're probably going to jack up the DOM.
Yeah.
Inserting that HTML into the DOM.
Yeah, I don't
at that client level.
Yeah, usually you'd have a separate API.
I think it's just asking if you can use it like old school MVC style, like
right.
Fetch the HTML yourself and then, you know, grab it and throw it in a pop up window or something if you're doing something like that.
I don't see why not.
Oh, yeah.
It might make sense if you have a large app that's written in, you know, an older framework and you want to slowly migrate pieces of it to React or something.
Yeah,
like
yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I still don't understand, like, how can this not, like, you want to throw a pop-up, how could this not use, if you turned off JavaScript, how could this render?
Exactly.
How can, you can't do a pop-up like events. This is just static.
Yeah, this is just a
style stuff for SEO.
This is all, what is it, like time to first pane or something is like a thing?
Right, this is the first request.
The first request. This is mainly
that.
The, okay.
Yeah.
You can't ever, it's not, never going to be able to deal with events, click events and all that.
It just gives you HTML.
No, you can. You just, if you shut JavaScript off, you're not going to get that
right.
React anyway.
Oh, but at least the home page would render.
Right.
Whereas right now,
exactly.
Yeah,
if you
want
right,
to disable JavaScript,
you're relying on
React
to do your rendering.
Right.
If you still
right.
want client-side JavaScript, it takes over, it like receives and then takes over from that point.
So you still would set up both a regular React, like your JavaScript?
Exactly, yeah. So
you still would have both, right? You have both
server
side and the client side.
Right.
Yeah.
So
people want to program front end apps. That's sweet for developers.
Mm-hmm.
So this is trying to make it easier to not have to worry about the server side rendering, so you can just focus on
the full-blown app, if, yeah.
I don't think anybody would.
So it's kind of your backup for people who, whether it's SEO or
right.
somebody who wants to block JavaScript.
Yeah.
Which is.
I've got a question. So I know a lot of people, like Netflix, for example, they might have their main API backend in like Java or some other language,
yeah.
But they still use Node to serve up the content for server-side rendering. I have seen though like Ruby and .NET and other platforms for server-side rendering for React. Do they offer any kind of like SDK or different options other than Node, just out of the box?
I don't think so, because it's kind of a convention over configuration. They I would think that that's one of their biggest assumptions is that you're at least writing a Node server.
Yeah, that would make sense. I was just curious if they did offer any alternatives.
No, I don't
handle
think
the
so.
Authentication too. Like, if you set this up with a form that, like, a login form would next
you
allow you to log in, or you?
No, that's definitely a service in itself. You use something like what
like
did StormPath get sold to?
No, they got sold on it.
Okta, yeah. So you use something like Okta or Firebase or something for authentication. Or, you know, you can just build a Node server. Just have sessions on your Node server inside and then have your database and store all your user credentials. So, yeah, this is primarily concerned with the front end and server side rendering. So, that is on the level as it goes.
Hey, do you know if this thing comes packed with service workers or no?
I've definitely seen a lot of talk about that. I haven't played with it. I don't think it comes packed with it, but they tried to make it able to work with service workers, I know.
What's a service worker?
Oh, sorry, it's for offline capabilities. So,
oh, for like...
Yeah, so offline for
yeah.
web applications.
Okay,
all right. Create React App actually packs it in now as part of Create React App, which is why I'm like, they adopted it, so.
Then maybe.
So it's probably coming soon.
Probably, yeah.
Facebook already adopted it.
They definitely develop right alongside of the actual React React library. Try to stay as close to using everything that they're using.
Cool. Does it support deep linking?
I mean, as much as deep linking is supported in any JavaScript app, definitely. So you're talking about coming from like an app to the web?
Like you'd have, you'd have your component and then you have some sort of like hierarchy within it, like say an order form and you have a specific order open. And when you open it, it kind of renders everything and brings up whatever that, like you have your main page piece that's your normal where they'd hit if they just hit the site, but there's deep linking, you'd be able to go into the site and kind of set some information within it to set up your components and all that.
Like URLs, like deep
links. I mean, I'm not exactly sure.
Like nested routes?
About that sort of
thing?
I would use local storage from what I can tell, from what you're saying, but. But yeah, I know that as far as working with, like, if you have an extension, if your app has an extension and that works with like a website, you know, that's all Chrome based, so you can do it that way, which is pretty cool. You know, like if you're coming from an app and you want the person to be able to continue what they were doing on your app in their browser kind of thing, that's pretty easy to do in React apps, period. So, let's do next. Let's see how this goes.
Case sensitive.
So now we got our navigation, and
I think that's because you're on the Mac. On Ubuntu, we've had that issue where my Mac developers when we they have it case sensitive, but the Ubuntu somehow is able to import the ES6 libraries with any case, you know, but the Mac ones we always had issues with.
So yeah, we can throw anything we want here now. If anybody has any specific use cases they want to address, that would be awesome. We love real world work. So
on the can you set it up to where that kind of your main outline of your page is always attached, or do you have to add it to each of your pages individually? Like the way you added the main wrapper on about the index?
Yeah.
Can you just say always use this one?
It's individual.
Okay.
You have to put it on every single page. You could probably write some logic to...
I'd like to see
it actually has a way to
some of that Firebase data in the state or something. Some sort of
yeah.
state into one of your pages.
Yeah, no, that'd be awesome. Okay, so...
I'd like to see you implement your... I don't know if anybody else is interested, but I want to see him implement some of the data from your web services. You have to install that Firebase in the app as well.
Yeah. So this Firebase. So let's go create a Firebase app.
Is that a paid for? So just the Firebase in terms of unlimited.
It's free for a long time,
yeah.
And you can even turn on pay as you go, and it probably won't charge you. Like I'm using it in production for a couple websites, and I get charged like 4 cents a month. So yeah, it's really cheap. But obviously, they make the money off of the big users anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure it gets expensive. So.
I think they jacked up their prices, like. Big time recently.
I think,
yeah, there was a Medium article where somebody got like a $100,000 bill.
Yeah, it was.
Or something. He was doing something stupid or legacy that it was like polling Firebase.
I actually
like,
saw that
every couple seconds
a,
or something. I forget what that story was, but
yeah, an Internet of Things device like logging into Firebase to ping it, and so it was getting all these auth connections.
Oh God!
Definitely not anyone's fault in particular. All right, so...
Quick question. Line 13, the link line, can you associate the fetch attribute with the link tag? And how would that work again?
Well,
the whole prefetch thing?
Yeah. Let's
forget. Line 20 now, yeah.
We're distracting you on another task.
Yeah, sorry about that. He's got
so
hijacked.
Nobody ever does that with you. Yeah. No one ever distracted a developer to change focus on
another
project.
All right, so we'll minimize this. Let's come back over here. Make sure we're getting the hard refresh. Hopefully that's the case. We can deploy it if we're not. Open up the network. All right. See if they still have the roll over. It's been actually a while since I heard about this. So roll over about, you see that fetch?
Yeah, yeah.
I just rolled over.
Okay.
And then I hit about, and it had resistance bytes. So I think the bulk
of the script is loaded.
Yeah, the bulk of it came when I clicked. Let's try that again. See what happens.
I think prefetch is production only.
Oh, let's check that out.
Oh, because you called npm run dev to get that local, but you call now and that pushes it to the production URL.
Yeah. Right. Let's see if we have the. Oh, it automatically copies the clipper. I never noticed that. So this is the screen it shows you as it's building things. It's kind of cool. I don't think it does. It does it if you're like on a custom domain. If you're actually hosting the thing for it.
All right.
What do we got here? What do we fill to get up? Okay. So hover over about.
Fetch
it just
when you load the page? Yeah. That's what I thought. That's when you load the page, it prefetches, right?
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, I saw the about request.
Yeah.
Now when you click about, is it a 302 not modified or 3 what
is
that?
Nothing happened then.
It's like that's like that. It's just loaded. Once it's loaded, it's cached,
so
there's no
304s.
Got it.
Yeah, let's try to capture this.
You check the box for disable cache.
Right.
Okay, so yeah, it's just prefetching. It's kind of just a traditional prefetch there. I thought it was doing some kind of like smart prefetching on hover and stuff. You might have to modify the prefetch a little bit. I'm pretty sure you pass actual arguments.
But it won't really ever slow the load of the page, the prefetch.
Right, exactly.
It's going to do it after the main.
Yeah, by the way, I'm looking at
down is complete, right?
Yeah.
I'm looking at the docs right now. The thing I asked about earlier, like manual prefetching, like comparatively calling function yourself, they do offer something like that. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
There's a router.prefetch you can call yourself.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, they have tons of options. And like I said, it makes it really easy to jump in. But that convention over configuration means that they have to have special ways of configuring things. So there's probably like a specific thing that you use to do the thing that you need to do. But there is most likely a way to do it. Without moving to a different server or anything like that. I'm pretty sure it's pretty universal. Because at the end of the day, in the next route is just JavaScript apps that get run from a node app. So you can just grab those files and run them through the Express app or something. It'll just work. So you can do whatever you want around there. Alright, so that's it. If there's any other questions to add about, I'm going to.
Yeah, is there anything else, anything you've run into where you've had issues with Next, that with the server side part of it, that you normally work on the client side, but ran into trouble running server side?
Not specifically client side, but from our dev environment, I thought it would be way easier to have SASS files. But it was just as hard as with Webpack. You pretty much just use Webpack. So I was kind of disappointed about that. What they want you to use is inline styles in your actual JavaScript components. The problem I ran into with that right away was that I wanted a full screen. I wanted height 100%, so I needed to be able to get to body and to the divs down to the actual app that's running.
You don't have access to body in this world?
No.
It depends on what library you use. Some of them will let you use global CSS, but maybe not the one that they support out of the box.
This one supports style JSX, so yeah, I'm not sure.
So you have to use that to style things from a style sheet perspective?
You don't have to at all. But that's what they assume. That's kind of what it's built around. To make it easy, just style the component you're on, that kind of thing. Keep it all in one place. It's great for separation of concerns.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm a SaaS freak, so I had to get that going.
is it possible to use it with like React like libraries by any chance, like Preact or Inferno or anything?